Hey guys, so good afternoon and welcome to an academy over here. I hope I am audible and visible to all of you here. In case I am, please let me know in the comment section. I am looking at your comments right now. Alright, so good afternoon guys and welcome to An Academy. I hope I am audible and visible to all of you here. So before we begin the discussion over here today, I would like to congratulate all our learners who've managed to secure a rank in UPSC CSE 2020. The results have just come out. So we have Jagruti Awasthi, who's our learner, who's secured All India Rank 2. In addition to that, there are a couple of, others who have ranks amongst the top 50 people who've cleared the examination. And in total, 169 plus Unacademy learners have cracked the examination that we've got to know of as of now, right? Furthermore, the ones who are preparing or who are wanting to prepare for the upcoming examinations here, guys, new batches have been launched for 2022 and 2023. The one-year batch for UPSC CSE in both the batches, that is the bilingual as well. Hello, Avril, I'm good. As well as the English batches are live. Furthermore, the 2021 batch, the details of the same are here, who's going to be teaching what subject. Furthermore, guys, the two-year batches are also now live on the platform, which are again bilingual and English batches. So this is the learner's journey and this is the faculty list, right? I will be taking up environment and ecology in this batch. Furthermore, guys, weekend current affair simplified batch will be there. It starts on the 29th of September. Hi, Abhishek. Those of you who are interested, you can join in for the same, right? Also, we are going to start with a mains program on the 18th of October. That is going to be Mission AIR1 batch, wherein we'll talk about quality enhancement and answer writing program. Also, dedicated answer writing sessions and ethics-oriented studies, as well as other GS topics for the mains examination, are going to go live shortly after the prelims examination, right? Furthermore, a couple of optionals have been launched. So those of you who want to start their optional preparation, you can do the same, right? Do not forget to take part in the combat this Sunday, and you can use the code SHREYALIVE, which is SHREYALIVE, to get yourselves enrolled for free, right? We've also added the raise a hand feature, live mentoring platform, loan facilities, and of course the course material, that is the books for your preparation. So you can have a look at that. Also, guys, you can avail the subscription because the prices are going to be increasing super soon, right? So those of you who are interested, you can look out and watch out for the same here. Right, so these were the couple of announcements I had to make. Now, going on further with respect to the discussion, guys, let's get to the next very important aspect of our discussion today. That is going to be the important places in news, right? This is going to be the last session pertinent to the important places in news. We've already had a couple of discussions pertinent to the same, right? So we have had three sessions already last week. This is going to be the last one in that series, right? So now going on further, we are talking about the world's largest icebreak, iceberg, which breaks off from Antarctica. Can you tell me what has been the reason for these kinds of, breaking of icebergs and glaciers and all those things? What is the basic reason behind this? Anybody? Also, guys, you can keep on commenting. I'm looking at the comment section, so I will be, monitoring that as well. Thank you. It's good afternoon. Warm ocean currents, yes, that can be the case, but more or less, if we are just to zero out on one thing, that is going to be the issue or the aspect pertinent to global warming, right? So that is the underlying cause or the root cause behind any of these activities happening over here, right? Now, what has happened? A huge ice block has broken off from the western Antarctica into the Weddell Sea. Yaad rakhna, Weddell, into the Weddell Sea is important, can be asked. Becoming the largest iceberg in the world and earning the name A76. A76 is the latest in a series of large ice blocks to dislodge in a region acutely vulnerable to climate change. Although scientists said in this case, it appeared to be a part of the natural polar cycle. The iceberg measuring around 170 kilometer long and 25 kilometer wide with an area of about 4,320 square kilometers is now floating in the Weddell Sea, right? So that makes the location and all those things important. So you see where exactly it is. You see how big, an ice block that is, right? So slightly larger than the Spanish island of Majorca, A76 has been monitored by scientists since it began to separate from the Ron ice shelf. Please have a look at it. Many times these kind of questions are asked. Alright, so I hope this is clear. So just have an idea with respect to where this A76 is located, where the Weddell Sea is there, right? So, and of course the island as well, right? So these things are important here. Now, please note that this is almost four times the size of Abu Dhabi. The island is that big, this iceberg that has been, that has just broken off. Now, going on further, talking about the next thing, that is eruption of Mount Nirango, Nirangongo, right? So this is very important. You all must have heard about it as well. It was in the news all this time. Hello, Kartikeya. Welcome to the session. I'm glad you joined the YouTube session also today. Good to see you here. I'm well. Hope you're doing well too, right? Chalo. Now talking about eruption of the volcano here. So thousands have fled as a volcanic eruption in the Democratic Republic of Congo, DRC, from Mount Nyiragongo on the outskirts of Goma city. The mountain here is an active stratovolcano. Please remember kis tarah ka volcano hai, stratovolcano hai, with an elevation of 3,470 meters in the Virunga Mountains associated with Albertine Rift. Then Nyiragongo's lava lake has at times been the most voluminous known lava lake in recent history. The depth of the lava lake varies considerably. Nyiragongo and nearby Nyamaragiriya are together responsible for 40% of Africa's historic volcanic eruptions, right? So that is the thing, right? Now, because this has erupted, it become, a couple of things gain relevance. First of all, the mountain's name. Secondly, the other volcanoes, and of course the kind of volcano it is a stratovolcano, right? So just have a look at the relative position, right? All right, this is also a good way to remember, great. Right, so you see where exactly it is located. It is almost at the, the periphery, almost touching Rwanda on its borders, right? As well as the, not very close to Uganda, but very close to Rwanda. But still, it's did not impact them much. It was mostly towards the DRC region only, right? Now, talking about the other major volcanoes of the world, we have plotted them over here for you guys. You can very easily have a look at them, the entire map. India does not have any particular, volcano which is that dangerous, right? So the big ones that we have here are Kilimanjaro that we speak about, right? Then we definitely talk about, for instance, Aconcagua, right? Then we talk about Krakatoa. Recently also it was in news, Mount Fuji, we talk about that, right? So these are the and of course we do have. All right, Kartike, I'll try and do one. I have not been able to manage time pretty well this month. I have a lot of work for now, but I'll see if we can do that, right? Also, just have a look at the one we have: Vesuvius, Etna, Santorini, right? These are also very important volcanoes, right? Please have a look at these. Just have a look at the map. If you have a doubt, ask me. Also, I hope you guys know about Mauna Loa and Kilauea, right? All of these volcanoes are also important. Mauna Loa is important. Krakatoa is important. Kilimanjaro is important. Aconcagua is very important. We definitely talk about Santorini, Etna. We talk about Stromboli, Vesuvius. Right? Kai bar they just can even give you like four relevant names and then they will ask you to arrange it as well. Probably in a north to south direction, in an east to west direction, in the series or sequence they have erupted in the recent past. So anything can be given according to that. Because we've had a couple of volcano eruption instances, this becomes very, very relevant. Can someone tell me which is India's only active volcano that is there? India has only one active volcano. What is the name of that one? Also, a little more hint, it's not in mainland India. Have you guys heard about the Barren Island? The Barren Island volcano in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, right? Group of islands jo hai. Yes, very good Shoaib, very good SS, it is indeed Barren. So Barren Island volcano is there. Also, can you tell me which part of India had, did have massive volcanoes at one point of time? Kaun se, India ke kis part mein ek point of time pe bahut zyada volcanic eruptions hui hongi? Which part of India had massive volcanic eruptions at one point of time? The Deccan Plateau region, guys. We have not the Nathan, the Deccan Plateau basically, right? So the Deccan Plateau has had multiple volcanic eruptions at one point of time, hence the black soil all over, right? So that is the region that we have to talk about here, right? So that is about it. Okay, chalo. Now going on further, let's talk about the Pandavleni complex. What is that? So the Archaeological Survey of India, that is ASI, has found three more caves in the Tirashmi Buddhist cave complex, also known as the Pandavleni near Nashik, Maharashtra, right? The Pandavleni complex or Nasik caves are a group of 23 caves carved between the 1st century and the 3rd century, also called as the Trirashmi Buddhist caves. This complex was first documented in 1823 by Captain James Delamine and is now an ASI protected site. Though additional sculptures were added up to about the 6th century, it is a major landmark of changes in Buddhist devotional practices. Right, so that was there. This is exactly what the caves look like. They have been covered in the newspapers as well. I guess Hindu also shared an image of the same like last year sometime. It was in the paper, right? Now please note that most of the caves are viharas. I hope you know that there are two kinds of caves. We have chaityas and viharas, right? For cave 18, which is a chaitya of the 1st century, BC is before Christian era, guys, before Christ era. So the style of some of the elaborate pillars or columns, for example, in caves 3 and 10 is an important example of the development of the form. The Pandavleni name sometimes given to the Nasik cave, good afternoon Sam, has nothing to do with the characters like Pandavas characters in the Mahabharata epic. Other caves in the area are called as Karla Caves, Bhaja Caves, Patan Cave and Berse Caves, right? So these are the other caves in that complex that are important, or rather in that area, that have gained prominence in the recent past. Now we talk about sea snot outbreak in Turkey. What is sea snot? So usually if someone would say what is sea snot, they would assume it to be certain animal or something like that. It is not. So sea snot hai kya? It's like green sludge that is there, right? Excuse me. So there has been a growing environmental concern in Turkey over the accumulation of sea snot, which is a slimy layer of gray or green sludge in the marine countries. Very good Aces, absolutely correctly answered. So in the country seas, which can cause considerable damage to the marine ecosystem, right? So that is the case over here, right? Sea snot is a marine mucilage that is formed when algae are overloaded with nutrients as a result of water pollution combined with the effects of climate change, right? So that is what happens. Yes, very good Aces. Eutrophication is correct, the correct word usage. Now, a sea snot outbreak was first recorded in the country in 2007. Back then, it was also spotted in the Aegean Sea near Greece, right? So that is exactly the aspect over here. So you see, this is what it looks like. So it covers or engulfs the entire area. It's like a layer of slime, a greenish brown layer of slime that is there, as you can see in the image as well. Now, by the current outbreak in the Sea of Marmara, and by far the biggest in the country's history, the nutrient overload occurs when algae feast on warm water caused by global warming. So that is also another issue here. Even if it's not when there is eutrophication, even when they get warm waters, right? They do have certain nutrients already there. So warm water is basically the condition which is very, very ideal for algae to be thriving on it, right? So that is how it basically becomes like this. And furthermore, water pollution adds to the problem. Environmental experts have said that overproduction of phytoplankton caused by climate change and the uncontrolled dumping of household and industrial waste into the seas has led to the present crisis, right? Please have a look at the areas, right? Isme kafi important cheeze hai, right? So Dardanelles Strait is very, very easily visible here. So are the Bosphorus Strait, that is also, easily visible, and the Marmara Islands, right? So you can see both of them also here. So what do we have? We have the Dardanelles Strait right here towards the western flank. Then we have northeastern side by Bosphorus Strait. You can very, very easily see the Sea of Marmara in between. And this is where exactly this outbreak has taken place. Please have a look at the map. If you want, to clarify any doubts, you can ask me. All right. Going on further then, guys, no other comments or doubts. So let's go on and talk about the next one. So Dihing Patkai in Assam is the 7th national park now. Very important. Please take note of this. You are most certainly asked questions from here. So Dihing Patkai in focus a year ago for illegal coal mining in the vicinity encompasses the erstwhile Dihing Patkai Wildlife Sanctuary, the Jaipur Reserve Forest and the western block of the Upper Dihing Forest Reserve. The 234.26 square kilometer Dihing Patkai straddling Eastern Assam's Dibrugarh and Tinsukia districts is a major elephant habitat and 310 species of butterflies have been recorded there. Right, the park has 47 species of reptiles and mammals including the tiger as well as the clouded leopard, right? So these are also important here. So this is where Dihing Patkai is located. Now going on further, talking about the Sardar Sarovar Dam, right? The Sardar Sarovar Dam is providing irrigation water in summer for the first time in history. The Sardar Sarovar Narmada Dam is a terminal dam built on the Narmada River at Kevadia in Gujarat's Narmada district. Four Indian states, that is Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra and Rajasthan, receive water and electricity supply from the dam. The foundation stone of the project was laid out by Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru on 5th April 1961. Oh, that's great. Then you must be knowing where this is located, Shubhajit. Right? Now, this is the location of the Sardar Sarovar Narmada project. Please have a look at it. If you have a doubt, ask me. I hope this is done. Now going on further, guys, the project took form in 1979 as a part of the development scheme funded by the World Bank through their International Bank for Reconstruction and Development to increase irrigation and produce hydroelectricity. Called as the lifeline of Gujarat, it usually has no water for irrigation during the summers. Right, so that is the issue behind it. Now talking about the Sahel region. So the massacre of at least 160 people in a border village in Burkina Faso over the weekend is a grim reminder of threat the Sahel region faces from religious terrorism. So this is the news piece from last year. The Sahel is an eco-climatic and biogeographical realm of transition in Africa between the Sahara to the north and Sudanian savanna to the south, having a semi-arid climate. It stretches across the south central latitudes of northern Africa between the Atlantic Ocean and the Red Sea, right? So that is an important aspect with respect to it. This is where we have it, right? So this is the region over here, right? Please have a look at the countries which the Sahara Desert covers or borders, right? So we have so you see Sahara Desert upar hai, uske niche aapka Sahel region aata hai, right? So Sahara Desert, you can very easily see Morocco is there, Algeria is there, Tunisia is there, Libya is there, Niger is there, Chad is there. सुडान इज़ देयर एंड इजिप्ट इज़ देयर, राइट. उसी के बिल्कुल नीचे द सहेल रीजन कवर्स मरुशियाना, लाइक इट कवर्स मॉरिशियाना, इट कवर्स सेनेगल, इट कवर्स माली, इट जस्ट वेरी वेरी मिनिमली टचेस बुर्किना फासो, वी हैव नाइजर, वी हैव नाइजीरिया, चैड, सुडान and Eritrea, right? So these are the regions which are going to be, you know, the one that we are talking about over here, right? So that is about it. Now the name is derived from the Arabic term for coast shore. This is explained as being used in a figurative sense in reference to the southern edge of the vast Sahara Desert. The Sahel parts includes from west to east parts of northern Senegal, southern Mauritania. You can see all of it over here, right? So we have Senegal as well, right? So we have parts of northern Senegal, southern Mauritania, central Mali, northern Burkina Faso, the extreme south of Algeria, Niger, the extreme north of Nigeria, the extreme north of Cameroon, and the Central African Republic, central Chad, central and southern Sudan, and the extreme north of South Sudan, Eritrea, and the extreme north of Ethiopia, right? So these are the regions which are a part of this, area, or which are known as the Sahel region here. Now going on further, coming to the next aspect, talking about Nat Geo recognizes Southern Ocean as the globe's fifth ocean. The Southern Ocean, also known as the Antarctic Ocean, comprises the southernmost waters of the world ocean, generally taken to be south of 60 degrees south latitude and encircling Antarctica. As such, it is regarded as the second smallest of the five principal oceanic divisions, smaller than the Pacific, Atlantic and Indian Oceans, but larger than the Arctic Ocean. Over the past 30 years, Southern Ocean has been subject to rapid climate change, which has led to changes in the marine ecosystem, right? So this is where we have the Southern Ocean, yes, as you can very, very easily see. Or bilkul next to Antarctica, we have the Weddell Sea and of course the Ross Sea. Is that clear? Alright, now going on further, coming to talking about the Yellowstone National Park. Now, why is it important? A new assessment of climate change in the Yellowstone National Park shows that it has lost a quarter of its annual snowfall. Yellowstone National Park is an American national park located in the western United States, largely in the northwest corner of Wyoming and extending into Montana and Idaho. Yellowstone was the first national park in the US and is also widely held to be the first national park in the world. The park is known for its wildlife and its many geothermal features, especially Old Faithful Geyser, one of its most popular ones, right? That is there. Now, this is where the Yellowstone National Park is located in the United States, right? So, that is there. Theek hai? Chalo. Now, going on further, while it represents many types of biomes, the subalpine forest is the most abundant. It is part of the South Central Rockies Forest ecoregion. The area also represents the one point where three major river basins of the western U.S. converge. The rivers of Snake Columbia Basin, Green Colorado Basin and Missouri River Basin all begin and snow on the continental divide as it weaves across the Yellowstone peaks and plateaus, right? So the rivers of the Snake Columbia Basin, Green Colorado Basin and Missouri River Basin all begin as snow on the continental divide as it weaves across Yellowstone's peaks and plateaus, right? That is there. Next, we speak about the Black Sea. So please note that Russia accused Britain of spreading lies over a warship confrontation in the Black Sea. The Black Sea is the marginal sea of the Atlantic Ocean lying between Europe and Asia, east of the Balkans, south of the East European Plain in Eastern Europe, west of the Caucasus, and north of Anatolia in Western Asia. It is supplied by major rivers, principally the Danube, Dnieper, and Don. The watersheds of many countries drain into the sea beyond that six share its coast, right? So that is very, very important. So just see where Black Sea is located, right? So can you very easily see the countries that are going to be there? Can you see very easily where is it located? So I hope you can very easily point it out. Can anybody tell me through which strait can we join the Sea of Marmara with the Black Sea? Kaun si strait hai? Also, I hope you can see that on its borders, it has Turkey, it has Bulgaria, it has Romania, it has Ukraine. Moldova does not share the border, please remember. Then we have Russia, Georgia. So we have all these countries. So we have Turkey, we have Bulgaria, we have Romania, we have Ukraine, we have Russia, and then we have Georgia, right? So all of these are there. I would want you to reconsider Dara Dinalis hai ki nahi, ek baar fir se socho. You remember I showed you this image over here, it is like this is something very basic guys. Ye maine baar baar bataya aap logon ko. So see, Sea of Marmara opens into the Black Sea through the Bosphorus Strait, right? Whereas the Aegean Sea and the Sea of Marmara are connected through the Dardanelles Strait, right? So ye important hai, Dardanelles, yes, very good. Dardanelles jo hai, that can basically joins with the Sea of Marmara with the Aegean Sea. So Aegean Sea and Sea of Marmara are connected to the Dardanelles Strait, whereas Sea of Marmara opens into this Black Sea, or Black Sea opens into the Sea of Marmara, whatever you want to call it as, through the Bosphorus Strait, right? So that is how it basically is there, right? Important hai, please make sure you guys remember this. Many a times you do get questions either in terms of which areas is it connecting, which particular strait is going to be connecting it to which particular sea or ocean, as well as the countries on its borders. Also, we have Sevastopol right over here. Agar aap dekho Black Sea mein, it's in the middle of the Black Sea almost. It's an important site. Now talking about the Lemuru Elephant Reserve. Where is the Lemuru Elephant Reserve? The proposed Lemuru Elephant Reserve in Chhattisgarh in the pipeline for 20 years has become the subject of yet another controversy over the reduction of its size, right? Then we speak about the Great Barrier Reef. Chinese official has said that the political tensions between Beijing and Australia were not behind a UNESCO recommendation to place the Great Barrier Reef on its endangered list. The Great Barrier Reef is the world's largest coral reef system, composed of over 2,900 individual reefs and 900 islands. It is stretched for over 2,300 kilometers over an area of approximately 3,44,400 square kilometers, right? So that is exactly how we have it over here. Please remember, this is exactly the Great Barrier Reef. It's a kind of barrier reef, as the name suggests, right? So we have different kinds of reefs. We have patch reefs, we have atolls, we have fringing reefs. This is a barrier reef. Barrier reef is the one where it is running parallel to the coastline, as in this case, right? So this one is going to be a barrier reef because it is running like exactly parallel to the coastline. The reef is located in the Coral Sea off the coast of Queensland in Australia. It was the World Heritage Site listed in 1981 by UNESCO as the most expensive and spectacular coral reef ecosystem on the planet. So this was an account of a particular set of important areas or sites in news, guys. Now we will go on to the last one that we have to take up in this series for important places in news. That is going to be like this one here. Tomorrow we are going to cover the important international groupings, right? So kal hum log important international groupings padhenge again at 12:15, right? So we'll be reading that tomorrow. Now we talk about Nord Stream 2 pipeline project. So what is this? The US, which had previously imposed sanctions to prevent the completion of a major new gas pipeline between Russia and Germany, has now signaled its approval for the project. It is a system of offshore natural gas pipeline running under the Baltic Sea from Russia to Germany. Right, it includes two active pipelines running from Vyborg in Lubmin, near Greifswald, forming the original Nord Stream, and other two further pipelines under construction running from Ust-Luga to Lubmin, named Nord Stream 2. Read through this slide. If you have a doubt, ask me right away. Just read through if you have a doubt. Alright, now going on further. So this is exactly where it is going to be, the areas where it is going to be running from here, right? So as we have just read, it's going to be running under the Baltic Sea from Russia to Germany. So you see the Baltic Sea shown in white here, and it is going to be running beneath the same, right? Now in Lubmin, the lines are connected to the Opal line to Oblernahu on the Czech border, and to the Nil line on to Rendon near Bremen, right? The first line, Nord Stream 1 was laid and inaugurated in 2011, and the second line in 2012. At 1,222 kilometers in length, Nord Stream is the longest subsea pipeline in the world, surpassing the Langeld pipeline, right? So that is the one that we have here. Now talking about the South China Sea dispute, nobody is not, known to it. It's something that is known to all of us. Nobody is, hearing it for the first time here. So please note, Pentagon chief has said that Beijing's expansive claims in the South China Sea have no basis in international law. Taking aim at China's growing assertiveness in the hotly contested waters, it is a dispute over territory and sovereignty over ocean areas and the parcels in the Spratlys, two island chains claimed in whole or in part by a number of countries. So China, Vietnam, the Philippines, Taiwan, Malaysia and Brunei all have competing claims. This is the area that we are talking about, right? So you see Paracel and Spratly Islands here. So all of them, claim it to be their own territory. Then we talk about, alongside the full-fledged islands, there are dozens of rocky outcrops, atolls, sandbanks and reefs such as Scarborough Shoal and others here. So Scarborough Shoal is an important area. Otherwise, also, I think we've discussed it previously as well. China claims by far the largest portion of the territory and area defined by the 9-dash line, which stretches hundreds of miles south and east from its most southerly province of Henan. Beijing says its right to the area goes back centuries to when the Paracel and Spratly Island chains were regarded as integral parts of the Chinese nation. And in 1947, it issued a map detailing its claims. It showed the two island groups falling entirely within its territory. Those claims are mirrored by Taiwan. Then we talk about the Agalega Island, very, very important. Ye bahut bar news mein raha hai of late. Very, very important. Make sure that you guys definitely know about it. So please note that Mauritius has denied a report that it has allowed India to build a military base on the remote island of Agalega. Agaliga are two outer islands of Mauritius located in the Indian Ocean, about 1,000 kilometers north of Mauritius Island. Very, very important. Agaliga Island bahut zyada important hai. The islands have a total area of about 2,600 hectares. There is basically an MOU between the governments of Mauritius and India to develop the Agaliga Islands and resolve infrastructural problems faced by the Agalians, right? That is over there. This is the area where we have it. So यहाँ पर बहुत सारे important areas हैं. So you have Seychelles, you have Maldives. इसी के बिल्कुल right on the eastern side of Africa, eastern flank, we have Madagascar. Above Madagascar, we have Assumption Islands. We have Agaliga Islands towards its east, and we also have Diego Garcia over here. Very, very important. Assumption Island की जहाँ तक बात करें, so there is an MOU with Seychelles to build an airstrip docking facility there. Madagascar has an Indian listening post, and MOU with Mauritius to build airstrip docking site. That was the important aspect or USP of the Agaliga Island. बहुत important है, contentious area है, बहुत बार news में रहता है. Make sure you guys remember the same. Now, what is the unease over Agaliga over here? So the Agaliga archipelago basically consists of two sparsely populated islands about 965 kilometers north of the mainland of Mauritius. It has a population of 300. India's involvement in the Agaliga project has caused disquiet in Mauritius. The MOU for the project was signed in March 2015 during Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit. It is to commence in February 2019 and end in 2021. India agreed to provide approximately around $87 million to build an airport terminal, extend its runway and refurbish the jetties over there, but then nothing has come of it yet. Next, we talk about the Ningbo port. So China has partially shut down the world's third busiest container port, the Ningbo port, after a worker tested positive for COVID-19, which is how it was in the news. This port is the busiest in the world in terms of cargo tonnage. It handled around 888 million tons of cargo in 2015. This port is located in Ningbo, Anzhoushan, on the coast of East China Sea, and Zhejiang province on the southeast end of Yangzhou Bay, across which it faces the municipality of Shanghai. This is where it is located, right? So it's one of the busiest port that they have, Ningbo port, right south of Shanghai. So you can have a look at it over here. I hope this much is clear. Now, going on further, guys, this port is at the crossroads of the North-South Island and coastal shipping route, including canals to the important inland waterways to interior China, the Yangtze River to the north. The port consists of several ports, which are the Beilun, the Zhenhai, and Old Ningbo Harbor, right? So these are the ones that are there, Beilun being a seaport, Zhenhai being an estuary port, and Old Ningbo Harbor being an inland river port over here. Theek hai ji? Now, talking about four new wetlands added to the Ramsar list. So we have the Bindhwas Wildlife Sanctuary, that is the largest wetland in Haryana, which is a human-made freshwater wetland. Over 250 bird species use the sanctuary throughout the year as a resting and roosting site. The site supports more than 10 globally threatened species, including the endangered Egyptian vulture, Steppes eagle, Pallas fish eagle, and the black-bellied tern, right? We can see where exactly, and the second second important site that has been added over here is the Sultanpur National Park. Sultanpur National Park from Haryana supports more than 220 species of resident winter migratory and local migratory water birds at critical stages of their life cycles. More than 10 of these are globally threatened, including the critically endangered sociable lapwing and the endangered Egyptian vulture, sacred falcon, Pallas fish eagle, and the black-bellied tern. Right, so that is where we have the Sultanpur National Park. Then we talk about the Thol Lake Wildlife Sanctuary. So the Thol Lake Wildlife Sanctuary from Gujarat lies on the Central Asian Flyway, and more than 320 bird species can be found here. The wetland supports more than 30 threatened water bird species, such as the critically endangered white-rumped vulture and the sociable lapwing and the vulnerable sarus crane, common pochard, and lesser white-fronted goose, right? So that is over there. Furthermore, we talk about the Vadhvana wetland. It is again in Gujarat. So Vadhvana wetland from Gujarat is internationally important for its bird life as it provides wintering ground to the migratory water birds, including over 80 species that migrate on the Central Asian Flyway. They include some threatened or near-threatened species such as the endangered Pallas fish eagle, the vulnerable common pochard, and the near-threatened Dalmatian pelican, grey-headed fish eagle, and Ferruginous duck, right? So this is a map of all the wetlands in India. So there are 26, then it went to 27, then it further increased, and now it stands at a total of 46 Ramsar sites in India. So India now has a total of 46 Ramsar sites. Next, we talk about the water shortage in Colorado River Basin. So the federal government in the US has declared a water shortage for the Colorado River Basin due to a historic drought. The Colorado River flows from the Rocky Mountains into the southwestern US and into Mexico. The river is fed by snowmelt from the Rocky and Wasatch Mountains and flows a distance of over 2,250 kilometers. Like River Ganga flows through a distance of roughly around 2,500 kilometers across 7 states and into Mexico. So that is like how much of a distance does it cover. This is the Colorado River Basin as to how it looks like, a very vast area that it covers. Next, we talk about Cattle Island on the Hirakud Reservoir, right? The Odisha Forest and Environment Department is all set to begin Island Odyssey and the Hirakud Cruise Ecotourism packages for tourists to island inside the reservoir. Cattle Island is one of the three islands in the Hirakud Reservoir that has been selected as a sightseeing destination. When large numbers of people were displaced from their villages when the Hirakud Dam was constructed on the Mahanadi River in the 1950s, villagers could not take their cattle with them, right? Please remember. They left their cattle behind in the deserted villages as the area started to submerge following the dam's construction. The cattle moved up to Bhuja Pahad, an elevated place in the Thilia Panchayat under Lakhanpur block of Jharsuguda district. Subsequently named Cattle Island, it is surrounded by a vast sheet of water. Right? Speaking of the other islands, then there is an island of bats also within the reservoir, just 1 kilometer away from the Debrigarh Ecotourism Project. It is the habitat of hundreds of bats. Tourists also get a magnificent view of the sunset from the reservoir. Sunset Island is one of the three stops on the unique boat ride. Okay? So thank you very much for attending this session over here, guys. We have discussed all of the important sites here. If you still have a doubt with respect to anything after this, you can please feel free to reach out to me. We will also be having a session tomorrow wherein we will be discussing about the important international groupings, right? So that is the portion that I will be taking up for discussion in tomorrow's session now, right? So that is going to be all for the discussion over here for today, guys. Thank you so much for attending the session over here. I hope you guys have understood everything clearly. In case you still have a doubt with respect to anything, please feel free to reach out to me, right? So on that note, guys, we will be continuing with the discussion tomorrow now, sharp at 12:15. Please don't be late, right? So on that note, guys, study well, revise well, and take care. Stay safe. Take care of yourselves and your family members. And I hope you guys have a great day ahead. I'll see you guys tomorrow. Have a great afternoon. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Goodbye.